We welcome all of you tonight. Pray that we'll have a good and a profitable time together.
Amen.
We, as usual, welcome our live stream audience also. Tonight we're going to be in John, the third chapter, verses 25 through 27. This will be our 37th exposition of this text. Now, beginning with the ministry of John the Baptist, the entire landscape of the Jewish community and theology changed. We have no record of any prevailing interest in the things of God between Malachi and Matthew. That doesn't mean there wasn't any. I mean, there's no record of any prevailing interest in the things of God. There were occasions when Israel sought the Lord because of impending danger, and they'd pray, you know. Mm-hmm. And there was plagues and punishments and transgressions. They sought the Lord during that time, but very, very few times where there was there like a renewal. Sometimes it was Hezekiah sparked a renewal, you know, Josiah sparked a renewal, but they were very sparse and far between. When the Lord had chastened them severely, then at times they'd repent and turn back to the Lord. The psalmist said this, kind of summarized in their history. Psalm 78:33. Therefore their days did he consume in vanity, and their years in trouble. When he slew them, then they sought him. And they returned and inquired early after God, and they remembered that God was their rock and the high God their redeemer. See, that it would take some buffeting before they'd had to be pretty severe. Now that's the manner of those that live under the law. That's the way it is. Because the law imparted no strength, no moral or spiritual strength. So it was more, it actually provoked people to go astray because it was against their natures. But beginning with John the Baptist, the people came for the first time to hear a message. Now this was a kind of a new, because he did no miracle. John the Baptist did no great works, miraculous works. But he had a message and it was backed with divine power and the people flocked out. It was some phenomenon. This had to be God because there wasn't any history of this kind of thing happening. Flocked out to hear a message and to repent of their sin. They were aggressive to do it. And then when Jesus came, the thing picked up. It got even greater. Men began seeking the Lord for who he was and what he promised, rather than for alleviation from affliction and escape from punishment and things of this sort. They discerned in Jesus that he had power. I don't know if I would try to think if there was any record where they brought their sick to somebody in before Jesus. And he had the brazen serpent, I understand that, but people from diverse parts of the country bringing their sick to somebody, I don't think this was practice. It wasn't normal, to say the least, but here they are. They're bringing sick, multitudes of them, bringing a sick to Jesus because they saw in him something that was different. They hadn't seen this in anybody else. When men are offered regimented ways to overcome debilitating transgressions, that are these transgressions being viewed as habits and addictions, there's really been a major departure from the gospel. See, the gospel's not the draw. That's not the gospel doesn't draw that way. That's not how the gospel works. So we see this in John the Baptist and in Jesus also. Now let's look at our text, John 3, 25 through 27. And there arose a question between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purifying. And they came unto John and said unto him, Rabbi, He that was with thee beyond Jordan, to whom thou bearest witness, behold, the same baptizeth, and all men come to him. John answered and said, a man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven.
Amen.
I want to break this text open here tonight as well as I can. It's a lot here. There arose a question between John's disciples and some of the Jews. Some versions say a Jew. It was one, but I'll stick with some of the Jews.
Yeah.
Now, prior to Matthew, it was rare to read about any kind of question. You have to do your homework to see if what I'm telling you is not the truth. The words question, questions, questioned, questioning, all occur five times from Genesis through Malachi. And four of them have to do with the Queen of Sheba questioning Solomon. There was one where Hezekiah questioned the priests and Levites concerning the heaps. The heaps were a lot of offerings that were brought in for the priests to sustain them because a kind of a renewal was going on. And they realized they neglected this, and Hezekiah inquired about those heaps. What do we do? What do we do with all this massive? So I asked the priest, what do we do with all this? And they told him, well, they bring this in for the priest. And so then he commanded that a place be prepared to house this, to warehouse these things. But that's the only question, mm-hmm. that, aside from Sheba's, that most versions have. Now, those two texts represent 1,500 years of the history of the Jews. And it was not a time when people were asking a lot of questions. By way of comparison, the word question in its various forms occur 28 times from Matthew through Titus. Questions. See, as soon as something significant is declared, questions will rise. That's the way it works. Provokes them. The religious culture was so significantly changed, commencing with the preach of John the Baptist, that people begin to have questions. They ask questions. When Jesus, they even ask about eternal life.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah.
But then they ask questions. There were actually discussions about the things of God, which was very rare, mm-hmm. at least from a record viewpoint, very rare. So that tells us something about the impact of light. See, those that sat in darkness have seen a great light. That's when Jesus started to minister. And that light pulled things out of people that normally weren't pulled out. You've probably experienced this yourself, that people have asked you questions that they haven't asked anybody else. See, because they saw that's light, that's the effect of light. It shows that there's a lot of stuff people don't know, but they don't realize it till the light shines. Now, some of the disciples of John, the word disciple, that was rare too. You didn't read much about anybody who had disciples. That was a strange phenomenon. In fact, the word's only mentioned one time from Genesis to Malachi, disciples or disciple. One time. And it's in Isaiah 8:16 when God said, bind up the testimony, seal the law among my disciples. That's it. That's it. You got to see that under law, it doesn't promote following a faithful person. It doesn't. This isn't what it produces.
Amen.
To follow someone, it has to be someone with light and power from God. So disciples, that was a strange phenomenon. There were people that gathered others around them, like Gamaliel named two of them.
Yeah.
And he named two because it was like this, even this was unusual. This was an unusual type thing. Here's his words in Acts 5:36. For before these days rose up Theudas, boasting himself to be somebody, to whom a number of men, about 400, joined themselves, who was slain, and all, as many as obeyed him, were scattered and brought to naught. After this man rose up Judas of Galilee in the days of the taxing, and drew away much people after him, he also perished, and all, even as many as obeyed him, were dispersed. That's your introduction to discipleship before John. That's your introduction to it. We gather from this that discipleship was not at all common.
Yeah.
Neither were the men who gathered disciples. Gamaliel hinted at the fact this doesn't work out too well.
Yeah.
Someone gathers disciples, they generally comes to naught. But with Jesus, John the Baptist, and with Jesus, the idea of disciples began to increase.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, people wanted to follow. They wanted to follow mm-hmm. John the Baptist.
Yeah.
And he was a strong preacher. Now, he was not your milksop preacher, not John the Baptist.
Yeah.
Strong, provocative preacher. They wanted to follow him. And Jesus came along in multitudes. Followed him. These people were not insurrectionists like Barabbas. They weren't that kind of people. They became disciples because they're being taught something. Though the disciples of John, they encountered some Jews, and in their discussions, some questions arose about purification. Now, let me read some of the other versions, and you'll kind of pick up on what he was talking about. The NIV says ceremonial washings. We were talking about purification ceremonies. That's what the questions arose about. Ceremonial washings. The Basic Bible English says washings. Holman Bible says cleansing rituals. God's Word Bible says purification ceremonies. About making things pure, International English. Ritual purification, International Standard Version. A ceremony of washing, Contemporary English Bible. And the Message Bible says the nature of baptism. And washings, the word used there is baptizo, baptizings. So as the text will confirm, the question that arose was over baptism. Whether it was like the washings under the law. If it was like a ceremony, like they had under the law. So questions arose about this. And I imagine that what it was, is it better to be baptized by Jesus than by John? Because they're going to tell them, look, Jesus is down there baptized, and everybody's going to him. And I mean, which should we choose, which baptism we, which one's the best? Or to this day, there are people take trips to Israel and are baptized in the River Jordan. They think that's better than being baptized someplace else. See, this is still, people still think this way.
Yeah.
Which one's the best? What do we do about it? Now, the law stood in diverse washings. Hebrews 9:10 says it stood.
Mm-hmm.
That is, it was, it's positioned the people around meats. Eat this, don't eat this, drink this, don't drink that, and diverse or different kind of washings. The New Revised Standard Version says different baptisms. Now, their washings, let me mention some of these diverse means different kind of washings. See, remember, these disciples of John, they're connecting John's baptism with the ceremonial washings under the law. Some say that there were proselyte baptisms. I never have found any proof of this. That before the Babylonian captivity, there's no evidence that they practiced proselyte baptism. But this is, almost every commentary brings this up. So that's not what they're talking about. The priests were dedicated with washing. Exodus 29:4. When Aaron and his sons went to the tabernacle, they had to wash their hands and wash their feet. A leper that had been cleansed had to wash himself with water. Before putting the priestly garments on, the high priest had to wash his flesh. If a person had eaten an animal that died of itself or that was torn by beasts, he had to both wash his clothes and bathe himself with water. A person who had touched anything unclean was required to wash his flesh with water. In the offering of a red heifer, following the offering, the priest had to wash his clothes and bathe his flesh with water. Now, these were all ceremonial washings. It didn't change anybody. It didn't affect the heart. It didn't affect the mind. It didn't affect the affections. It was an external, outward ceremony. The cleansing of the flesh, what that filth of the flesh means, that it authorized them to traffic among the people again.
Yeah.
When the people were unclean, they couldn't even like walk around in the camp.
That's right.
They had to wash, and then they washed, and they could walk. So that's a ceremony. See, a ceremony is something you go through that doesn't really do anything to you. It signifies something that really is not part of you at all. Now the question arose with John's disciples and the Jews, whether the baptism of John or the baptism of Jesus was to be preferred. Were they ceremonies? Now if you were to raise this question today, there are still people that think baptism is a ceremony.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. A mere ceremony, maybe I should say. Now, this same kind of question arose at Corinth, except it centered around preachers. Some said, I'm of Apollos. That's my preacher's Apollos. Does it not? Cephas, that's the one I follow. Another says, Apollos, that's the one I'm following. Notice now what Paul asked them about this. He first asked if Apollos died for you or anything like that, and then he said, were you baptized in the name of Paul? So their baptism was what he... See, they had a ceremonial view. That's why that's the only reason you would have a favorite-like preacher. You're looking at things from the outside, from appearance. That's what a ceremony is. It's from the outside, not inside. So they came to John with this question. They came unto John and saith unto him, Rabbi, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, and so forth. Now I want to say a word about baptism into Christ, because I'm ashamed to say this, but the people that practice baptism are some of the people that know the least about it. I hate to say that, but that's the way it is. At this point, we ought to establish that baptism, into Christ is not a ceremony, and a mere ceremony, and that this is what Peter taught in 1 Peter 3:21. Here's what he said. The like figure wherein do even baptism, but now save us, not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, you notice that parenthetical statement. It's inserted in. It's an explanatory statement. It's not like a straight flowing sentence. Not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God. Now some of the versions, they so grossly distort this, I'm ashamed that things like this are in the hands of the public. But they are. And let me read how some people translated this. New American Standard Bible says, not the removal of dirt from the flesh. NIV says, nor the removal of dirt from the body. Basic Bible English says, washing clean the flesh. The Holman Bible says, removes dirt from your body. New Jerusalem Bible says, washing off of physical dirt. Living Bible says, not because our bodies are washed clean by the water. International English says, not getting rid of body dirt. Weymouth's New Testament says, washing off of material defilement. Williams' New Testament says, the mere removal of physical stains. The Message Bible says, washing away dirt from your skin. The Amplified Bible says, and not by the removing of outward body filth, bathing. None of those are right. They are 100% wrong. And the men who translated them show how ignorant they really were. They just copied a dictionary definition. They had no idea what Peter was saying. So that's why I want to deal with this. Not the putting away of the filth of the flesh. That is, it wasn't. That's what a ceremony did. It didn't cleanse them of moral filth. It just meant they could traffic among the people. That was what that's what it did. That's not what baptism does. In baptism, the conscience is affected. A ceremony doesn't. It's possible that during a ceremony, someone's thoughts might be expanded, but the ceremony itself did not do anything to the individual. So now at the obtaining of a good conscience, so that tells you this is not a mere ceremony, because it's the blood of Christ that purges the conscience from dead work to serve the living God. So anyone who gets a good conscience, it wasn't a routine that did it. Further, baptism saves us.
That's right.
Not because we did it, but by the resurrection of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Now, let me read that sentence without the parenthetical statement, so you get the full thought. The like figure wherein do even baptism doth now also now save us by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's the thought. So that's, now you got a conscience, you got the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that transports it outside the domain of mere ceremony. It is something outwardly that's done, but not only outwardly. Ceremonies were only outwardly. Yes?
What would you personally, how have you handled people that have not been immersed, that have been sprinkled as infants or sprinkled as adults?
They're telling them they haven't been baptized.
Mm-hmm.
You haven't obeyed the form of the dove.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's right. What's the implication of that?
I don't. The implication is up to them. See, I don't have to give any implication. The fact that they have not obeyed the doctrine, they didn't do what Jesus did, they didn't do what John the Baptist did, they didn't do what the Ethiopian did. They did something, they were taught to do it now. This wasn't their own conclusion. And that's what I tell them. You just the same as you deal with Paul dealt with the people at Ephesus. It was just a different kind of baptism. But he said, God doesn't give people the Holy Spirit who are baptized differently than he ordained.
And it's likely that those brethren there in Ephesus had been baptized by immersion.
Well, of course they had. That's the only kind of baptism there was.
They were rebaptized.
It was a John's baptism.
Mm-hmm.
For remission of sin, too.
Yeah.
It was for the remission of sin.
Yeah.
See, that's... I think a lot of people with whom I was identified practiced John's baptism. That's what I think. They don't call it that. I understand that. But I think that's what they're actually practicing.
Yeah, just to comment on that. By the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, that's drawing our attention to the operation of God that takes place in baptism.
Yeah.
Because he joins us to Jesus Christ. And that just shows the importance of the resurrection. Because if Jesus isn't raised, then baptism is an ineffective practice. But because he is raised, that's what makes it effective, because that's that operation that takes place.
See,
that's who we're joined to.
When God invests a form with significance, ignoring it cannot be justified under any circumstances. Even Israel was baptized in the cloud and in the sea. The cloud, I mean, everywhere this is mentioned in Scripture, there's no question about what it means. And when they washed in the laver, they just didn't dip a cup in the laver. He was washed in the laver. And it's tragic that this condition exists, but this is what Father falling away has produced. Now you've got this situation of multitudes of people that have been told they were baptized. Mm-hmm. We don't question their hearts. It's their minds that was deficient. Their understanding was deficient, but somebody's got to tell them the truth. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now you could have argued, if you were a Pentecostal, you could have argued that the house of Cornelius didn't have to be baptized because they actually visibly, it was attested, they received the Holy Spirit. But Peter commanded them.
That's right.
See? Even though it was a unique situation, you understand, the acceptance of the Gentiles, this was not your normal situation. But Peter, when he, go ahead.
You've got other believers who have been immersed, but they've been told it has nothing to do with their faith.
That's right.
Or their connection to Jesus.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
They've been told that.
That's right.
Maybe a person was told that their baptism had nothing to do with salvation. That doesn't mean that that person believed that. See, so I can't judge their conscience by what someone told them. But if they were not a stable type thinker, they would assume that this was the case. And the strongest argument to me to be baptized in the first place is the one given to Philip, just that Jesus was baptized. That ought to end.
Yes, that's right.
And he said it was to fulfill. This is what Jesus said.
Yeah.
It was to fulfill all righteousness.
Yes, yes.
Now, a person has to be in a bad state to reason that you shouldn't be baptized, don't have to be baptized. Here was John the Baptist trying to talk Jesus out of it. Jesus wouldn't have anything to do with that.
Yeah.
Well, the point I wanted to make here was that baptism is not a mere ceremony. There is an outward action involved, but the outward action perfectly comports with what's happening behind the scenes. Any valid form has to comport with the doctrine.
Yeah, that's right.
It has to comport with the doctrine. You take like the Lord's table. Mm-hmm. Bread corn is bruised, the Bible says, crushed. So this perfectly depicts the bruising of Christ's body.
Yes.
Juice is crushed out of the grape. That perfectly comports with Christ, the way he died. His life was forced.
Mm-hmm.
See, it by judgment from God. It perfectly comports with the doctrine.
Uh-huh.
So the disciples of John, they bring this matter up. Here's a person baptized and he's successful. All men are coming to him. So the crowd's changing. It appears as though it changed gradually. For a while they were ministering simultaneously. It's he that was with thee beyond Jordan, on the other side of Jordan. Now at the time this was said, John was in Ainon near Salem baptizing. That was northwest of where they were. So that's what say the other side. They've been up there at that. When you were down on the other side of Jordan, you were on the other side. See, when they went up north, they were on the east side. When they were down south, they were on the west side. So it says the other side of Jordan. It doesn't mean you're looking across the other side. It was a different location.
Mm-hmm.
Notice how these people remembered that.
Yeah.
I was with you beyond Jordan, and to whom you bear witness. Now, what did John say about Jesus? Well, I don't claim this is a complete, but give you some idea. He said, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, but he'll burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. That was a phenomenal amount of information. I don't think any prophet was that thorough what he said about Jesus in that compressed sentence. Here's another saying. This was he of whom I spake, he that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. See? Yeah. Who's going forth from everlasting, the prophet would say. Behold, the Lamb of God which taketh away the sin of the world. He said that two times. I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him, and I knew him not. But that he sent me to baptize with water, the same said to me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same as he that baptizeth with the Holy Ghost. I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. He that hath the bride is the bridegroom. He that cometh from above is above all. See, that's some things he said that was, these people remembered. They remembered what John said about Jesus. Mm-hmm. They probably remembered what he said to the soldiers, you remember? And what he said about how people should conduct themselves. They probably remembered some of that, but the main thing they remembered is what he said about Christ. Yeah. In spite of John's witness, though, these disciples still weren't following Jesus. Yeah. Interested. He told him pretty plainly who he was. He's preferred before me. He came from above. He's greater than me. I got a decrease. He's got an increase. See? But these disciples of John, they still hadn't left John and following Christ. Mm-hmm. God was patient with them.
Yes.
God was patient with them. It took a while for this transition to take place from the old to the new. The same baptizeth. Now, so far as they were concerned, the issue was not, it was purification. Remember, that was the issue. That's what happened. The feasts, this law of old had diverse washings, which were for purification. That's what they were. So they've been talking about this. Whose baptism is the best? Who do we get clean from? Was there competition here? Should we make a choice to be baptized again by Jesus? See, until Jesus came, John is the only one that was baptizing. Uh-huh. Now we got another one baptizing. So the disciples of John there, they don't want to live as though John is unimportant. And all men come to him.
Yeah.
They're flocking to him. The crowd's changing. There's plenty of people coming to John, too, but more people are coming to Jesus. Yeah. Even though John said he's preferred before me, but they hadn't put this together yet. Now, we get a sense here of what's involved in giving one's allegiance to Christ.
Yeah.
It's really not a simplistic procedure. Particularly if they have a religious background.
Yes.
It's not simple. This is telling you, these were sincere people. These were devout people. But to switch from John the Baptist to Jesus, this wasn't something they were going to do hastily. This took some thinking through.
Uh-huh.
Things were still a little foggy.
Yeah, that's right.
See? Things hadn't been cleared up yet like they would be the other day at Pentecost. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
These disciples of John were thoroughly persuaded that he was God's man.
That's right.
And his message was from God.
That's right.
And they needed to heed him, and everybody should heed him.
That's
they were
right.
Persuaded of that. So it was not an easy thing for them to turn to someone else.
See, so you, all of you have probably experienced this same thing, having to adjust the way you think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
It can be challenging. For some people, they never have thought very much. Uh-huh. So the... Well, it's doubly hard for them. They got to learn to think.
Yeah.
Some people have thought, but they've thought crooked, based on erroneous postulates, and so you've got to be patient. You got to be wise. You can't just produce standard arguments all the time.
Yes.
You've got to assess the person, to know how to answer the person, because each person has a little different background and slant.
Mm-hmm.
This is one reason why Jesus must continually be preached.
Amen.
the gospel of Christ must continually be preached, because this simplifies things for people. It ever keeps Jesus before the people who he really is, see? And it facilitates them making the decision to follow Christ with greater ease. If someone just hears the gospel the first time they were converted, and that's all they ever heard about Jesus, that's all the gospel's ever preached to them, and the people thought, well, that's enough, it'd be easy to confuse these people, see?
Yeah.
See, it must be preached continually because of this condition. Well, you wonder how John's going to answer this. Of course, he was filled with the Holy Spirit from his mother's womb, so he's going to know how to answer.
Amen.
He was a man sent from God, filled with the Holy Spirit from his mother's womb. So here's what he says. A man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven.
Yeah.
Now, I know that a 20th century person would say, what does that have to do with our question? Other versions read, a man can receive only. No one can receive anything except to be given to him from heaven. A man is unable to receive anything. No one can do anything. It's not possible for any person to succeed. I'm talking about eternal success. That's the Message Bible. A man cannot take anything by his own choice. The Amplified Bible says, a man can receive nothing, he can claim nothing, he can take unto himself nothing. Now, this is a broad statement. As indicated, receive nothing. I take it this includes being chosen for the work, being commissioned for the work, having power to do the work, and realizing results through the work. See, that has to do with that whole gamut of things. Those who are conducting labors for the Lord cannot take the honor unto themselves. They can't just decide this is what they're going to do. It may look that way, and the way it works out, it may seem to the person that's what actually happened, but that's not what happened. It happens with you the same way it happened with Jesus. Here's what's said of Jesus. No man taketh this honor unto himself, but he that is called of God, as Aaron was. So also Christ glorified not himself to be made a high priest, but he that said unto him, thou art my son, today have I begotten thee. So not even Jesus picked this thing out. God commissioned. See, he received it from above. His Father sent him and commissioned him. As used here, the word nothing, it does mean just precisely that. Absolutely nothing, nothing whatever, not at all, in no wise, nothing. That applies to anything and everything pertinent to carrying out the work of the Lord. Anything that enables a person to carry out the work of the Lord, anything, doesn't make any difference how minuscule it may be, anything that's required to carry out the work of the Lord is either received from God or it's not received.
Amen.
Nobody can confer it on you. That's John's answer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He's explaining, look, Jesus couldn't be as successful as he is if it wasn't given him from above. See, that's what he's saying.
Mm-hmm.
Men cannot create or confer credentials to fulfill an office God ordained.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, men don't believe this.
Mm-hmm.
And it took a few centuries before men struck out on their own, but they finally did. They struck out on their own, and there's different levels of it. Catholicism, swung the pendulum way over to one side, that you get credentials from them and only from them.
Yeah.
See, but the others have followed in the same train, and if you listen to men, they'll tell you can't preach if you're not certified by men. You don't want to buy that.
Amen.
Got to be liberated from that.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Usually, what they really mean is you can't preach in our churches unless you. See, that's what they really mean.
Yeah.
So then, when you say that I won't preach in your churches unless someone asks me to come there. Men do wrong to take the responsibility upon themselves. In my opinion, no individual that is doing a valid work from the Lord should allow one of his peers to confer a license on him. He should not receive it. It's a personal, this is a personal thing. I'm not saying everybody should do this. This is my, how I feel about it, and what I recommend, but what a person does is their own business. But it's not necessary. I'll never forget a man, something I heard, a black evangelist that came to DeSoto, and we were there, not DeSoto, Hornet Christian Church. He came and he preached a revival there. And he was one of the, he walked through the audience. And I'll never forget, he's standing in the right hand rear corner of the building. And he shouted out, "Your credentials are your gifts." As soon as he said it, I saw it. I saw that that was it. It's the aptitude God's given you. Yeah. That's your credential.
Amen. Yeah.
That's what authorized. You got it from heaven.
Amen.
Except to be given him from above. So he, you're presuming that if a person's successful in the right way, he has received something. John has said he received it from heaven.
Amen.
He didn't receive it from men. Except it be given him from above. Other versions say, unless it have been given him from heaven. It is not given to, and if it is not given to him from heaven, unless God gives it from heaven. The New Living Translation says, God in heaven appoints each man's work. If heaven has not given it to him, see, he can't get anything if heaven has given it to him. A man must be content to receive the gift which is given him from heaven. There's no other source. The source of everything required to be a laborer together with God is from heaven.
Yep.
That's what John's saying. No resource comes from earth. No resource comes from men. Not wisdom, not aptitude, or anything else.
Yeah. Amen.
You saying we shouldn't be educated? That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying in the work of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
What's required has got to come from.
Yeah.
Got to come from God. If you do have, I mean, we're not advocating that people that are ignorant throw themselves into the work of the Lord. What we're saying is, whatever, if you are educated person, let God use your education. Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
What then has to happen is that people have to recognize that gifting.
That's exactly it.
I think it's naive to think that everyone is going to recognize
And
see, that was the case with John.
Yeah.
That not everybody received John's baptism. Jesus said later that the Pharisees were not baptized by John. They had rejected John's, but the people had recognized that he's a prophet.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
So this is not a science.
Oh,
it's not a cut and dry thing. A person can be sent from God. And a whole generation may reject
that
person.
That's right.
And the church has done the same thing. The church has made this mistake too. The church is not infallible. There have been men that God has sent to the church, and the church has rejected them.
Yes.
That has happened throughout the centuries.
Amen.
Yes.
Yeah, that is an important distinction to make. This has to do with the worker, not the hearer. There's another responsibility of the hearer to test the spirits. Yes, Sister June.
You were making a point about the education of the Apostle Paul was highly educated, and they refused his message too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So what you're saying now, I think both of you are kind of saying it, that it does have to be from the Lord to be valid, and those that have honest and good hearts, the Lord works in those hearts to receive that message.
Amen.
I mean, whenever we say salvation is of the Lord, that's exactly what it is.
Amen.
On both ends of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, amen.
This is not saying that everyone that appears to be successful has got their resources from God.
Right.
See, this is speaking about the work of God that's being done. So there are some people that they've got something on the ball because they heap a lot of people around them, but it's not their message. See? So this doesn't mean that everyone, as Brother Jason as well said, it doesn't mean that everybody's going to recognize this. But the person who's representing God, he's got to recognize it. That's the point. He's got to recognize it. And then if he does and preaches in the power of the Spirit, then those that whose hearts are right, they'll recognize it.
Mirror example of this is Jeremiah.
Jeremiah.
Right. His generation did not receive
him. Right.
They attempted to assassinate him 2, 3, 4 times, even some members of his own family.
That's right.
Can I give in?
Yes.
Just considering when you said that all of our resources come from heaven, this means that we are thoroughly dependent upon the Lord.
Say that again.
This means that we are thoroughly dependent upon the Lord.
That's right. That's exactly it. Amen.
Yeah. Mm.
Amen. See, John knew that Jesus' ministry was valid. He knew his message was powerful.
Yeah.
Those that heard Jesus do. No, we never heard anyone speak like this before.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what he's addressing there. But Jesus himself was rejected by Jerusalem.
Yeah. You can see that John
saying this mostly for his disciples' benefit. Because he knew that this was Jesus. This was the one that God sent, the Christ. And yet, he wanted to help them see it.
That's right.
Yeah.
Now, here's what I think he was establishing. That there is, in the kingdom of God, there's no competition between the laborers. The competition exists where some laborers, maybe none of the laborers got anything from God. But maybe some got from God and some didn't. See, competition, but so he's assuring them that Jesus is not competing with him, and he certainly is not competing with Jesus. He's already said, I'm going to decrease. I'm going to decrease. He's going to increase. See? Their work had been, every person's work has been assigned to them, and it will not conflict with some other member's work.
Amen.
Yes.
When you said that John the Baptist is doing a work for Jesus, and Jesus is working through him, but Jesus is in conflict with himself. And so that's why when Jesus was doing his work, that's why he backed down.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah.
Just as in, remember, this was an interim period. Law and the prophets were until John. It's an interim period. In that interim period, God-ordained ministers did not compete with one another. Now, the New Covenant era begins over here. During the New Covenant era, God-ordained ministers do not compete with one another. Now we're getting down to individual members in the body of Christ. Now we're getting down to but they do not compete with one another.
Yeah.
Not if what they got is from God.
That's right.
See?
Yeah.
This is an argument. This is a strong argument for this. If you see some member of the body, and like Stephen and Philip, they rise to prominence. You don't say, "Why? I wish I could do that."
Yeah.
They got that from God.
Amen.
Now Jesus is administering the kingdom, of course. God is the sovereign over all, and he has turned everything over to Christ, given him the reins of the kingdom. And Jesus is the only potentate. See?
Yeah.
He's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He's the King of saints. He's the mighty God. He's over all, the Lord of all. He's called the governor in Matthew 2:6. He's the head of every man and the head of the church. So that's where, now on this side of the cross, that's where the things are coming from.
Yeah.
They're coming from Christ, in whom the fullness, all fullness dwells. But no person who is laboring with Christ gets his resources from somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
They all come
Amen.
From heaven, particularly from Christ. Concerning the misconception of competition, a similar thing was seen with Christ's disciples. They had a little difficulty with this also. This is before Christ died. John came to Jesus one time and said, "Master, we saw one casting out devils in thy name, and he followeth not with us, so, and we forbade him because he followed not us." He thought that was competition. Same kind of thing. Thought it was competition. Jesus said, "Forbid him not. For there is no man which shall do a miracle in my name that can lightly speak evil of me. For he that is not against us is on our part." Now that's a pretty weighty saying. You have to But Jesus said that, so that is the absolute truth.
That's right.
So when you see someone working for the Lord and the result of their work is something you know is right and valid, just receive it. Yes, Brother Jeremy.
Yeah, it seems like this is just the flesh is like can't think beyond its own little group.
That's right.
Yeah.
This is how God is. I mean, and then I thought about how you were talking about how God, he picks people like Father Abraham. He picked him up and told him what you're going to do. He told him what he was going to do. He didn't go to a special school or whatever. God picked him out and made him who he was.
Amen. Think of the liberty that you've got in Christ Jesus, brother. There's all kinds of people that wear the name of Christ. Not all of them are despots. All of you know people that are from a completely different background than you are, yet you know they're of the Lord. See, you are free to receive them.
Yes.
Without having to explain why they're not a member of a group you were a member of or why you aren't a member of their group. You're free to receive anybody who ministers the truth of God to the Spirit of Christ. You can doesn't make any difference whether they're with you or not. Because this man was performing, casting out devils, and he wasn't even with the disciples. So the disciples, you can't do that. You're not with us.
Thankful that John did this because he's helping his disciples to reason beyond appearances.
That's right, amen.
He's helping them to see that there is more than meets the eye. And so whenever you look at a group of people or a person in a group, you've got to reason deeper than what is on the surface appearance.
Amen.
And that's where we find that liberty, because a lot of times there's a temptation to judge according to appearances or by associations.
Yeah.
And that's not wise.
Amen.
We
need to
reason deeper.
Amen.
Yes. This thing, whoever's not against us is on our side. It was. In other words, truth never works against truth.
Amen.
Yes, Brother Jason.
I don't know where I read this, but I read this somewhere, and I think it's very helpful. This person was talking about how you make judgments about a person. Are they in? Are they out? Are they real? Are they fake? And he said something like this. He said, every person you meet, you don't know the end of their journey.
That's it.
And so he said, there are some people you meet, and at the moment you meet them, you think this person's out. For whatever reason it may be.
Yeah.
Maybe it's moral, maybe it's doctrinal, maybe it's the group they're in. But you don't know later on down the road they may be in.
That's right.
Now you may meet people and you say, this person's in.
Yeah.
They're on fire.
Yeah.
You don't know. They may fall away. So, that's something to consider also.
Now, you can only assess a current condition.
That's right.
You can't prognosticate about the future.
I was thinking, isn't it wonderful, though, that we don't have to send our young people off somewhere to be educated?
In
the things of God, that we can do this right here.
Yeah.
Back in the years ago, I guess they still do it, but when someone rose up in the assembly that they just didn't know what to do with them, they sent them off to be educated in the things of God. But we can do that here in the direction of the Spirit.
I can remember my own experience, all right? And things were a little better. When I was younger, things were a lot better than they are now. But that was what you did, you know, when you were, if you were on fire, you weren't a normal person, so they sent you off to school, Bible college. And I never forget my first day in Bible college. The kids were the same kind of kids I went to high school with. It floored me. It floored me. I didn't think that was what was going to happen. I heard some of the same things from teachers that I heard from high school teachers. It floored me. I didn't. It took me a while to get over this. I never did really get over it. See, you can't. Nobody can take the work of God in on themselves without forfeiting something. If God doesn't send you and equip you, and you try and do it anyway, you're going to be missing a lot of key things. And then also there were too many question marks. A lot of the teaching, they just gave you all the different views and you were in a quandary. Which one's right? You know, you didn't know. And very few men, there were some godly men who'd say, this is right. You know, they could, but there were a lot that they couldn't say that. You got to make up your mind. You imagine Paul saying, I'm going to tell you what the agnostics say, and here's what the Christians say, and here's what the Corinthians say. Now, you sort it all out.
Yeah.
That's not the way they taught. They gave you the straight stuff, and you had to compare everything else with that.
Yes.
Yeah. See, everything, but in a nutshell, everything is managed from heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Salvation reconciles you to the God of heaven.
Yes.
Salvation connects you with the risen Christ,
mm-hmm.
from whom all these supplies come. So it's a salvation sets you up to receive. It would be appropriate if you've been selected to do deacon work, then heaven will give you wisdom to do good deacon work.
Amen.
Use the office well.
Yes.
Purchase to yourself a boldness, like Stephen and Philip. See, but they got their resources. They had to negotiate among widows that were dissatisfied. Well, I would think that would require some wisdom, you know. How are you going to keep things from going, breaking out into tumult?
Mm-hmm.
They received from heaven.
Amen.
Yes.
And the people had to recognize
right.
these qualities in these
That's
brothers.
Right.
They'd look out among themselves and choose.
That's right.
And this wasn't like 50 or 60 people.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking thousands of
That's
people.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But already these two men had distinguished himself
yes.
among the people.
Amen.
I think that's true of any assembly, really. Uh-huh. Yeah.
A couple of points that are kind of related, but mm-hmm. maybe not very related. I want to go back for a moment to the subject of baptism. I know from, this is just my own experience and perspective, but I've been able to talk to a lot of people that have come into churches where I've served from different church backgrounds.
Mm-hmm.
And have questions about baptism, whether they came from a church that, well, I was baptized, but I was told it had nothing to do with salvation. I've talked to many people like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I've talked to people who said, I was sprinkled as an infant, or I was sprinkled as an adult. But one of the things that I've always noticed about certain people is you can always tell a person that God is working in, because they're always seeking for the truth.
That's right.
Uh-huh.
And to do the right thing.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And so that's always something that I would look for. Whether
that's right.
If the person is saying, I was sprinkled as an infant.
Mm-hmm.
But what you want to look for though is, you know, Is the person seeking God? Are they serious?
Yeah.
Do they want to know the truth?
Yeah.
Are they dissatisfied with their ignorance? And when they learn the truth,
they'll obey it.
Yeah, and I've never had issues with that. Whenever someone was coming to me and this was on their mind, when I was able to clearly explain, this is what, you know, I think the Bible is teaching,
yeah.
I've
yeah.
never had anybody who was really serious
Amen.
And seeking have a problem with if they needed to be baptized, being baptized.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's This is a hard thing to juggle, but on one hand, you have the... I agree with you. I think the doctrine is clear in Scripture.
Yeah.
And actually, even the people who don't immerse know that.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. The doctrine is so clear, you can't reject what the Bible says. You have to just say, well, our church tradition basically trumps it.
Yeah.
But the doctrine is clear.
Yeah.
But what's not so clear sometimes, and what you have to deal with, is the human aspect of where the person is that you're talking to. I hope that...
Well, no, I know what you're saying.
Amen.
That's the way it should be. It shouldn't be any other way.
Yeah. The other thing I wanted to say on the subject of education, and I can speak about this because I have a lot of it from that perspective, there are two things I regret about it, mostly. And I've thought about this a lot in the last several years. The two things I regret about the education I received, one is the sectarian nature of it.
Mm-hmm.
When it came to this is our group, whenever that kind of entered into it, I think that's bad.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing I regret about it was the education from the standpoint of professionalism.
Yeah.
Or launching a career.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
But I do not regret studying the Bible.
Yeah. Oh, no. Yeah.
I don't regret studying even theology.
Uh-huh.
Even theology I didn't agree with. I think there's probably not... I could talk to almost anybody about theological or philosophical issues, and they're not probably not going to say something that I haven't heard before.
Yeah.
They're not going to catch me off guard. Because of the education that I've received. And I don't regret that part of it.
Oh, no, you shouldn't. See, education can be sanctified.
Amen.
Yeah, that's what it can be sanctified, which means you take what you can use and you drop the rest. God's not glorified by bad English and things like this. I mean,
I've also found that my education in the Scriptures... And I found this from experience because I've gone to public universities now. I can study anything.
Yeah.
My intellect has been prepared that I can study any academic subject and not be lost. And I think that's because when you study the Word of God, it's an education in and of itself.
Oh, yeah.
It disciplines your mind,
yeah.
And you can move into almost any area from that.
See, the mind has to be disciplined. I think here, this is where the Jewish manner of life, and I understand that their what we would call education was in the synagogue, where they learned to read, reason, think. So the undisciplined mind will not gain much from the things of God. That's what we call it, a scatterbrain. It just doesn't get very far. So the idea is when you get down to working for the Lord, you've got to receive what it takes to use what you have.
Yes.
It's it. And it's so that way we don't have to condemn anybody or anything like that. We just say when you get down to serving the Lord now, you have to use what God gives you. And he can sanctify the way your mind's been cultured. If it's been a valid culturing, he can teach you how to think. Like I think that if a physicist was converted and God sanctified the technical aspects of a physicist's mind, see, he would end up being able to see things that the ordinary person couldn't see. Now you can pick up yourself like this. My father told me this one time. He said, had I been able to have advanced beyond seventh grade, and he in middle of seventh grade, he went, I could have learned in a few years what it took me 20 years.
See,
to just learn how to think, learn where do you put a period and stuff like this.
Yeah.
Question about this matter of man receiving, cannot receive unless God gives to him. We've practiced, many of us here in this room have been ordained.
Yeah.
And we practiced it here in our assembly.
Yeah.
Where does that fit into what we've spoken of this
evening?
That's
saying that the persons recognize what God has recognize what God has
done.
That's
what I was thinking.
Yeah, that's what it is. Yeah, there's nothing magical about ordination. It when they sent out to, for instance, it was sent out to other churches, they did this so the other, they would send a letter. Paul said, now you don't need letters about me. But other people, they had to send letters out, which were the equivalent to...
I just want to make it clear that ordination is not conferring something that's not already there.
Oh, no.
It's confirming something.
Confirming. And recommending. And it's recommending. See, when they send out men, the early church send out men, they lay hands on them, and they recommend them, and accompanied letters would say, now, these men hazarded their life for the cause of Christ. Remember when they sent those men out with the letters to the Gentile churches, and they sent out... might call a certificate of recommendation. But that meant believers trusted each other too. Believers trusted each other. See, there are some people I know that I depend on, brethren that know them, I depend on their assessment. At least it's thrown in the hopper, so to speak. Well, I think that I'll close there. You can see that John was a peacemaker. There was a potential row. Potential competition, yeah, potential arguments. Quelled it down. That's just what Jesus did too. Don't forbid him. Don't forbid him. If someone's doing something that God has said needs to be done, don't be insisting that he be join your fellowship before he does it. Yes, Blair.
I was thinking about how this the question about purifying was a very central issue.
Yeah, amen.
And under the Jewish system, it had to do with coming before God. Well, so much does baptism.
Yeah,
have
amen.
To do with our acceptance.
Yes.
Amen.
And so you mentioned that this time was a transition time between what's called been called the intertestamental time, is between the old and new.
Yeah.
And so we see that this is like being directed by God. These questions result from things that God had established under Moses, and now he's revealing under Jesus. And there's similarities because
amen.
Of the shadow nature of the law.
Amen.
It wasn't just some never seen before obscure topic or issue or practice or something that people said, what's this? What Jesus and John the Baptist did reminded them of the law.
Amen.
And that's because it was a shadow of the things coming.
Yeah.
See, the law said you have to do it. And Jesus says you have to do it too. But the difference is something happens.
Yeah, right.
Something takes place in the person when it's done in Christ.
Yeah, yeah.
But if has been raised up, you don't have to do what God says, see? Then you miss.
That's right.
You miss all that.
Amen.
And the doing is in the power of his life, not in our
That's
doing.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
We're simply connecting ourselves to him.
That's why there can never be a question about whether or not I should do what Jesus said.
Yeah.
There should never be any question about that.
That's right.
Yes, Jonathan?
Earlier, concerning the matter of baptism, you'd mentioned Christ's baptism being, that's like enough reason for anyone to want to do it themselves. Well, I would add at least two things to that. One, that you don't have anyone in the scripture ever balking or questioning.
No, no one did.
Yeah, every time someone was faced with that commandment, they never resisted.
Yeah.
They always entered into it. So I said, that's a good reason. And also, baptism is always assumed or presumed in the scriptures. Like he spoke to the Romans, he said, know ye not, you were baptized.
Yeah.
Or the Galatians, like as many of you who have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Or even when he said, like, well, I'm glad I baptized none of you. He didn't say none of you were baptized. He said, I'm glad I didn't do it. Or, like, were you baptized in the name of Paul? I mean, there's things like that mentioned that where it's always presumed. It's not really a question. Is there an unbaptized Christian? That's always assumed in Scripture.
Yeah.
So that should tell you right there. That's just part of the process.
Yeah,
no one should believe that.
See, the Jews, they were different kind of washings, but they did have to be done.
That's right.
So they were raised up to think differently about should I do it. But they were taught, no, if the orders came from heaven, if it says wash your clothes, that is what you do.
Yeah,
right.
Amen.
All right, now when you keep that same mindset and you listen to what's said now. Yeah.
This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. Hear ye him.
Yeah,
amen.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, very good, brethren. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for these affirmations of Scripture and for the privilege of discussing them and sharing our thoughts without any kind of animosity or competitiveness. This is a great privilege, Father. Help us to guard this with a holy zeal, the right to discuss and investigate and pursue without enmity. And we commit ourselves now unto thee, and we take this opportunity, Lord, to ask you to remember your people during this stormy season and protect them and their properties so that they can carry out your work without distraction. In Jesus' name, amen.